is working for Oscar of the Waldorf, and one day Oscar said to him, "Listen, kid, if you're serious about this, and you seem to be, you're going to have to go to France and learn something." So Bruce goes to France and falls in love. This was somebody who was exposed for the first time to a place that codified culture. Food was culture. Literature was culture. The buildings were old, the buildings were beautiful, and it should be pointed out, it was nearly free for an American to live there. Well, Bruce did a bunch of things in Paris. He had what he referred to as a Dada catering company, which he worked with Butter Powell, who was Bud Powell's wife in fact, if not in name. And they would do Southern cooking. What they would do is they would show up and they would make dinner, or they would make whatever you needed for your dinner party with whatever you had.
And Bruce wound up plucking chickens in some, you know, bistro in the north of Paris. And that's how he began, you know. He was living in a working man's hostel.
There were no white boys turning up to work in kitchens in those days. It was only Algerians who were doing the work that Bruce was doing. And that was, you know, Bruce was an illegal immigrant. He could never get papers. So Bruce did what many illegal immigrants have always done, which is he went to the back door of a kitchen and they, you know, he sat there and he, you know, peeled buckets of potatoes and he peeled bushels of shallots. And that was how he learned how to do it. He was cooking at one point in the Hotel de Crillon, which has always had a fine kitchen. And as part of his compensation, he had a room in the attic. I don't remember if he had to go to the basement to bathe or if he had to climb more attic stairs. Whatever it was, bathing was clearly an inconvenience. And he talked about how he would go and he would buy pieces of toweling, you know, cut off a huge roll. And he would, you know, they carve off a piece of soap and he would use them until they were destroyed. And then he would go and they would carve off another piece of soap and another length of toweling. So what Bruce was romanticizing was a particular kind of working class drudgery and poverty.
And getting employment in the way people in the construction business get employment today. And they just say, you, you, and you, come on. Apparently in the Léal market in Paris back in the, it must have been the early 60s, there were similar kinds of things. And Bruce would go.
Bruce was entranced by the markets of Paris. They were beautiful, they were functional, and it was a place where nobody asked a lot of questions, so that you could, upon finishing your business, you know, and a chef gets off work late. So in France, which is a very bourgeois place, the only places open were in the market. So people would get off of work, and they would go to the market, and they would go to Opède Cochon, and they would have some pig's feet, and indeed, a bottle of beer. As we're farther away from the period where many people made their livings with their hands, right? You worked on a farm, you butchered your own cow, and Bruce got the tail end of that when he was living in Paris in the 60s. You know, the farmer would bring his crop to market in the infamous Duchevaux that was designed to hold one Frenchman and 50 kilos of potatoes. So he saw the tail end of the process where it really was farm to table. And each participant in that process, from the potato farmer to the person selling the potatoes, to the person buying the potatoes, to the person turning those potatoes into potatoes dauphinoises or pommes frites or potatoes on any one of the 100 potato dishes, everybody knew their job and strived to do it well. And Bruce was entranced by that. And in fact, who isn't? At that time, Léal was under threat because to have a world-class produce market in the center of Paris, even in the 60s, was obviously stupid. And Bruce banded together with other intellectuals and people tried to save it. And I think what Bruce, who would never be so romantic in his approach to something he needed in New York, in Paris, it was always different. In Paris, it was always perfect. In Paris, it was always filled with romantic possibility.
New York Herald Tribune! New York Herald Tribune!
He began to meet other people. He started to write. And, you know, within a relatively short period, he went from this callow kid who couldn't speak French to the food critic for the Herald Tribune. I mean, you know, just before Patricia Wells and Craig Claiborne and people like that were writing, Bruce was writing, you know. I mean, and, you know, at a remarkably young age, he was doing this.
People are like, oh, Bruce was the first food critic for the Herald Tribune. And it sounds really great. But it didn't pay a living wage. And nobody gave a shit. But Bruce, of course, was a young man and he was hungry. This was decent food. We should never underestimate the importance of somebody who's hungry. He scuffled around, publishing a lot of things, never making any money. Because the fact is, Bruce was really ahead of his time.
And then he started writing books in his 20s. He gave me one of his first books, a cookbook. He must have been 25 or 26 when he published it. What was amazing about it is not simply that it was a comprehensive cookbook, but it revealed such a depth of knowledge about food and food preparation.
It didn't matter how successful he was. After 10 years, he just couldn't pull it off anymore. You know, he was older. Bruce could never get working papers. He understood he wasn't going to be able to ever get into life in France the way he wanted to. But Bruce left Paris because Paris did not want him.